Okay, let's see.
Quite often there are this clapping sound, popping sound, almost like shooting.
This crackling kind of sound.
Like something is burning, like...
It was like, oh my gosh! And there it was.
One old man told me that I'm very sure that they make sounds, even if this were my last birds. So the aurora makes sounds.
People in the Arctic have reported hearing sounds from the Northern Lights for centuries. These accounts have long been dismissed by modern science as impossible, just a myth, or a product of auditory hallucinations. But could it be that the ancient stories were right all along?
Here at this location where we are now at Sodankylä, we have 150 nights per year the Northern Lights. To me, Aurora Borealis, in even its faintest form, is the kind of my friend. Northern Lights is nature's most beautiful color show, something which you should see once in your lifetime. Suddenly, the sky starts to flash like heavenly disco lights. If you go to 150 years ago, when the first scientists came here, they had no idea what the lights actually are. We started to understand when we got the first satellites. But even then, not yet fully.
The source of the Northern Light is come from the sun. It's basically two main sources for strong auroras. It's saw storms, and then you have what they call corona holes, which is a dark, huge areas in the sun's corona, which just sends out solar wind particles at very much higher speed than the rest of the sun.
So it's electricity from space, which rains into the atmosphere and makes atmosphere glow.
Well, the Earth has a magnetic field, which is created by the rotating core in the center. If we didn't have that magnetosphere, the solar wind would actually slowly blow away our atmosphere, so there wouldn't be any life here on Earth, actually. So luckily we have that one.
We have several invisible shields which protect us.
When a solar storm comes and connects with the Earth's magnetic field, then it will interact and it will shake up the magnetosphere and we're creating what we call a geomagnetic storm. So if you don't have a little engine on your satellite, you will lose that satellite much quicker because of the solar activity. And even the solar storms brings with it a lot of energy that's dumped into the atmosphere. And that is basically what's also creating the aurora. And you can easily understand that thousands of years ago, people were stunned or afraid when the whole sky was just kind of in flames.
The indigenous people here, the Sami people, they had some beliefs. First of all, you should always respect the lights. Never tease them, never shout, never wave your hand.
People took actually children inside sometimes because the Northern Light was known to steal children.
Grandparents and parents are saying, you should not tease the Northern Light, both us. In the evenings, of course, when it was dark, we used to tease it. Actually, we did. And we knew that we shouldn't. We have one story in Sami. Often it's two brothers. The youngest brother started to yoik the Northern Light. And he yoik the teasing words. Kuovsahas, kuovsahas, poidipihtanjälmis, härtangal, tsii, tsii. And then suddenly it was like a blizzard and he was burned there. And he disappeared. Only his fur was there on the snow.
I have heard it like two or three times in my life. I felt that it was something warning me. I could feel it in my body, like a magnetism or something.
Of course, the sound of aurora has been puzzling mankind for ages.
Lots of people think they can hear some crackling sound when there's a very strong Northern Light outbreaks. It's a space phenomenon from 80 kilometers up to 700 kilometers. And there's no air there, so it should be impossible for sound to propagate from that altitude down to ground. So if there is some sound, it must probably come from something closer. And there's many theories about what that can be.
I do know that they make, for example, infrasounds. We are recording here in this observatory also. But when we play these sounds to people who have heard them, no, this is not. After working now with Professor Unterleiner for some time, he suddenly, in the last years, he came up with an excellent theory about the possible physical mechanism of this sound.
I came to this result. We have to construct a microphone array, at least with three microphones. The three microphone system can give you the direction of the sound source. So then you can separate those sound sources in the environment, which are close to the ground. This pointing there, leave it out. But if the sound is coming here somewhere, then pick it.
Untulaina's inversion layer theory posits that on cold, clear nights, an electrical charge builds up in the air in an inversion layer about 70 meters from the ground. The same geomagnetic energy that causes auroras in space acts as a trigger, releasing the electrical charge in the inversion layer, causing pops and crackling sounds.
The sound source is below 100 meters. Aurora light is rapidly changing. The sound is almost immediately in your ears. And this is really why people speak about auroral sounds. So they associate the sound so strongly with the light movements. But what causes the light movements is changes in magnetic field.
I think Untulainen's theory is very important. It tells about the various energy transfer mechanisms.
The northern light, of course, is a beautiful thing to see, but every time they store northern light, it's also what something called space weather.
If we want to understand our environment, we should know all these energy transfer mechanisms in detail in order to build a perfect model.
The same solar storm, the same effect on the sun will also interfere with our technology-based society today.
We are so much dependent on our technology in space, our satellites.
We only have been hit once by a superstorm. And that was in 1859, which we call the Carrington event. It was so strong that the northern light was seen all the way down to equator. It took down the entire telegraph system. Some fires broke out in some of those telegraph systems.
Satellites simply die with too much electron radiation from space weather events.
The question is, what will happen if the Earth was hit by the same storm today?
If we would just imagine like this, that let's take out all the space action, we would just drop to the Stone Age. We all on planet Earth, we are astronauts on this spaceship. We want this spaceship to be preserved for future generations, and that's why we also need the space research.
Thanks for watching. This episode was part of PBS's Earth Month lineup, which includes a bunch of great new episodes celebrating our amazing planet. If you enjoyed this episode, we know you'll love the latest from India, Alaska, about a gardener working to improve food security by sharing indigenous planting techniques. Links to that episode and PBS's full Earth Month playlist are in the description.